Pretty sure you know this, but like with the microphones, Kevin told me just to try to get one of the different frequencies. Oh, I got you. So each of the colored microphones has a different frequency. So it's there's a red, a blue, a black, and a white. So since the white one is out, you want to make sure you don't grab the white pop mics.
Gotcha. That makes sense. Yeah, if you're doing the 2 and 8 number, turn the mic off.
Makes sense.
Yep, definitely.
Right here. All right, I think I'm in the way, so I'm going to get out of the way.
Yeah, And I also helped you with all of the workshop and some of the things that
Good morning. Happy Tuesday. Thank you. There you go. I'm Edith Deschel, director of the E.W. Scripps School of Journalism. And my assignment is to call the 2022 Schuneman Symposium on Photojournalism and News Media officially to order. So welcome, I'm glad you're here. I'd like to offer a special thanks to Dr. Smith and Patricia Schuneman, who for the last decade or more made contributions to make this symposium possible. So over the years, the Schoonemans have donated close to $500,000 to make the Schuneman Symposium, annual symposium, a reality. And I just want to take a minute to give them some love, to thank them very much for their contributions. And those of you all who know me, you know I'm a broadcast journalist by trade, and I'm not going to talk a lot. So I'm going to cram a lot of stuff in 30 seconds, a sound bite. But some of our speakers today who've traveled from across the country to be here, as you know, we're still in pandemic mode. And so a lot of our speakers may be caring for at-risk family members or family members who are not eligible to get the COVID vaccine. So since masks are optional now, if you choose not to wear a mask, that's perfectly fine. But please don't be insulted if our speakers who are still caring for at-risk family members may decline to have a selfie with you or to shake hands. Don't take it personal. It's just they have family to take care of. And for today, this year's symposium includes a bonus event. Tonight, we have a free screening of the Oscar-nominated documentary, War Photographer, featuring James Nakwe, who was scheduled to speak today, but he had to cancel because he's a war photographer. And what do war photographers do? They cover wars. And so he's in Ukraine right now, covering the war there. And so he's here in spirit. And so the screening tonight is at 7 p.m. is at the Athens Cinema on Court Street. And it's sponsored by the Ohio University Student Chapters of Society of Professional Journalists and the National Press Photographers Association. Our guest speaker this morning, Loren Holmes, and one of my former students, is featured in the exhibit up here that opened Monday and is hanging in the School of Visual Communication Gallery. Up here will be available through April 2nd. And it's in the Schoonover First Floor Center, Schoonover Center 140. And I'd like to ask my colleague, Professor Stanilaus, to come up and introduce this morning's speaker.
Thank you, ma'am. Good morning. How are y'all doing? Pardon me while I read this introduction of Loren, because I don't trust myself to do this off the top of my head. So please bear with me while I read this rather short introduction. First, I wanted to thank the Schoonemans personally. Their generous contributions have sustained this symposium and brought some incredible people to town and provided an amazing opportunity for our students and me and others here at the campus. And their most amazing people have spoken here through the years. And today and tomorrow are no exception. So thank you to the Schoonemans. So, as a photo editor, I hate portraits. They're boring. They're static, impersonal photographs. People just pose. Photographer snaps a picture, and it's unemotional. It is uninformative, boring. Well, most of the time. There are exceptions. Our first speaker, Loren Holmes, who's a visual journalist for the Anchorage Daily News, used portraits as an integral part of the newspaper's project detailing sexual assault in Alaska. Alaska has the highest rate of sexual assault in the country, almost four times the national average. Their project won the 2021 Ethics in Journalism Award from the Society of Professional Journalists. They interviewed about 30 assault victims. Loren's portraits gave power to these people who had often been denied by the court system and society. He made them real. To be able to make these kind of compelling photographs takes more than talent. It takes real humanity. To earn and deserve the trust of people, people who had their trust violated, takes a huge heart. Loren is that kind of guy. In 2020, Loren was part of the newspaper's team that won the Pulitzer Prize for public service. They looked at the lack of law enforcement across the vast and rugged state of Alaska. Again, his images were a critical component in helping an audience know and understand. Loren took us inside communities that lie beyond where many consider civilization to end. That's what Loren does. Loren introduces us, puts us face to face with people we might not meet otherwise. He helps his audience and us understand what is important to and for his community. Loren also takes us places we can't or won't go, places not so static or boring. While he is sensitive, this native Alaskan is equally as comfortable in the uncomfortable environment of his home state. For example, Loren has covered the Iditarod sled dog race 7 times. It often gets to 40 below at night out on the trail. That's cold. That's cold enough to freeze your sensitivity off. The warmth of Loren's work is revered beyond his audience. He has been awarded by the Pictures of the Year International Competition, the National Press Photography Association, the Society of Professional Journalists, and the Alaskan Press Club, just to name a few. Loren is that good. He holds a BA in philosophy from Carleton College. So someone can have beauty, bronze, and brain. I'm also proud to say that he holds a master's degree from the School of Visual Communication here at Ohio University. Beyond enjoying his presentation today, I encourage you to visit the gallery in Schoonover to see his work. It's worth it for you. In conclusion, yes, I am going to stop talking. Over the years, this incredible symposium, so graciously sponsored by the Schoonemans, I've had the opportunity to introduce some phenomenal people, my heroes, legends in the industry. Finally, today, I am thrilled and more than honored to introduce one of my favorite students, an incredible visual journalist, the one and only Mr. Loren Holmes.
Thanks everybody for being here. I'd like to thank the Schuneman family for their support of the symposium. I haven't been back to Athens since I graduated in 2007. Before I begin, I do want to recognize that Ohio University sits on the ancestral land of the Shawnee tribe. I'll begin today by sharing some background about myself and how I got into photojournalism. And then I'll share work from that project, Lawless, which looked at law enforcement and sexual violence in Alaska. And then finally, I'll share photos from the portrait project, Unheard, which was a follow-up to the Lawless project. And I should note that in both of those projects, I'm gonna talk about suicide and sexual assault. I've always been a visual person. Growing up, my dad had a darkroom in our house. And in high school, I spent a lot of time down there developing and printing black and white film. My interest in photojournalism specifically came from a high school mentorship program with the Anchorage Daily News, where I got to tag along with the photographers while they did their daily assignments. As an undergrad, like Stan said, I studied philosophy and environmental and technology studies at Carleton College in Minnesota. While I was there, I did work for the student newspaper, and I even freelanced a little bit for the local county newspaper. And of course, I took every photography class I could. I enjoyed all things photo-related, but it became clear to me that photojournalism was my passion. I love the idea of photojournalism. I love its dedication to truth, to real, genuine moments. I love the pace of it. I love that every day is a new challenge, trying to make a compelling storytelling image on a deadline. And I love that photojournalism lets me witness historic moments from up close, like this, the inauguration of the first Alaska Native Lieutenant Governor. And I guess more than anything, I love being able to be out in the world every day, experiencing life in my community and documenting it for as wide an audience as possible. After I finished grad school here at Viscom, and after completing an internship with Evansville Courier and Press in Indiana, I moved back to Alaska. I knew there was something really special about the place that I grew up, and I wanted to explore that as soon as I could. I freelanced and did an assortment of odd jobs for 3 years before I was hired full-time with the Anchorage Daily News. Alaska is the reason why America is an Arctic country. It's a huge state with many distinct regions, cultures, languages, and ways of life. And it's changing. This is a photo from McTarvik, which is a new settlement in Western Alaska. And it's being built to replace Nutuk, which is a village that's eroding into the ocean because of climate change. There are at least 3 Alaska Native villages that are actively relocating because of climate change, and 200 more that are threatened by climate change. A lot of my favorite photos are ones that'd be hard to find anywhere else besides Alaska. These next few are from the Iditarod, the nearly 1,000 miles dog sled race that takes place every March. It begins with a ceremonial start in downtown Anchorage, and then a time to start the next day. The course travels over mountain ranges and through some of the most remote parts of the state before finishing in Nome on the Norton Sound coast. Many of the Iditarod checkpoints are in Alaska Native communities. This is in Anvik, a town of about 70 people on the Yukon River. Like Stan said, it's cold up there, and weather is always a major factor in the race. Mushers have 14 dogs, and they travel no matter what the temperature is, or the wind chill, or the weather. And it's a hard race, both physically and mentally. This is Lance Mackey. He won the race 4 times. He not only has just 9 fingers, but he also suffers from Raynaud's syndrome, which leaves his hands with poor circulation and the constant risk of frostbite. Covering the Iditarod, something I've done 7 times, it gives you an amazing appreciation for the vastness of the state. This isn't an event that you could have anywhere else in the world. Maybe parts of Russia or Canada, but it wouldn't be the same. When I took this photo, it's the coldest I've ever been when making photos. It was 50 below on the river when this musher left the checkpoint of Huslia. The whole time I was waiting for him, I was constantly worried about my equipment breaking. At 50 below, everyday objects become extremely brittle, and the lubrication that keeps camera parts moving smoothly starts to freeze, and your batteries, they just die. Because the race covers nearly 1,000 miles, the landscape and the light changes with it. Once the mushers reach the coast, around 2/3 of the way into the race, the light changes. Mushers even spend some time crossing the frozen sea ice, which can become disorienting in a blizzard. If you follow the mushers on the GPS tracker, you can see them making zigzags when they lose the trail, trying to find it again. Every checkpoint provides a new backdrop to the race, and Unalakleet, the first checkpoint on the coast, the community of almost 800 people comes out to greet the first musher as they come in. Many of them wear traditional Inupiaq parkas and hold handmade signs welcoming mushers. While Alaskans have won the race more than anyone else, the Norwegians have a pretty good track record too. This is musher Yor Lisef Olsen, who won it in 2018. And I should mention that there's an Ohio-born musher who competes in the Iditarod. His name's Matt Fahler, and he's from Mansfield. You should follow him. He's a pretty interesting guy. As I mentioned earlier, Alaska, like everywhere else, is facing challenges due to climate change. But in the Arctic, the climate is warming faster than almost anywhere else. Forest fires in unpopulated parts of the state are left to burn, leading to giant fires that would be unthinkable anywhere else in the continental US. The scale of the fires means that homeowners sometimes have to defend their own property, like this man who's removing fuel from around his home ahead of the fire. Fires in Alaska might not get the national attention that other fires get, like those in California or the West, but it's still part of our story. Another part of our story in Alaska has to do with our sense of adventure. Every year on the 4th of July, the town of Seward hosts what might be the world's toughest 5K race, Mount Marathon. It's about the distance of a 5K, but it goes up and down a steep and dangerous 3,000 foot tall mountain. The most competitive men take about 30 minutes to get up to the top and only 10 to get down, jumping and sliding on the snow and loose rock in a barely controlled free fall. When they finally get to the finish line, they're often covered in blood and mud with ripped clothes and faces showing mixture of exhaustion and fear. A relief, I mean. As a photojournalist in Alaska, I regularly travel on small single engine airplanes, and I also cover the crashes of those same kind of planes. This was a mid-air collision between a state trooper and a private plane. Alaska is also dealing with issues of social justice, just like many other places across the country. These four men have become known as the Fairbanks Four, four Alaska Native men who spent 18 years in prison on a murder charge before being exonerated in 2015. From the beginning, the case was deeply flawed, relying on discredited police tactics to secure confessions from the men. But even their exoneration wasn't without controversy. The state vacated their convictions but didn't admit any wrongdoing, and the men didn't get any compensation for their time spent in prison. In Anchorage, where about half of the state's population lives, housing and homelessness is a significant issue. This is Ariane, who is feeding her two-month-old daughter in a studio apartment that she rents with her husband and their two older children. The facility that rents the apartment provides transitional housing for homeless families with children, with the goal of getting them into a permanent housing situation within 6 months. Many people in Anchorage who are experiencing homelessness choose to camp, even with the risks that that brings, like the cold weather in Alaska. This is a woman named Amber that I met who is laying on a pile of her belongings that was removed from the homeless camp where she'd been staying. She said she had moved to the spot a few weeks ago after being attacked at her old campsite. And Anchorage, where I live, has struggled to provide adequate shelter space, especially during the pandemic. This is the city's largest sports arena, which was converted into a shelter at the beginning of the pandemic. When the new mayor took office, he abruptly changed the contract, leading to a lot of confusion and complaints from the residents who were already distrustful of the city. So next I'll talk about Lawless, which was our project that won the 2020 Pulitzer Prize for Public Service. In 2019, we began an investigation into sexual assault in Alaska. And this was a collaboration with the nonprofit newsroom ProPublica. The lead reporter on this project, Kyle Hopkins, was looking at cases of sexual assault. And as part of that research, he started compiling a database of law enforcement agencies in the state. And through that investigation, he made the shocking finding that a third of all communities in Alaska don't have any sort of local law enforcement presence. Those are the red dots on the map. And these aren't ghost towns. Our analysis only included communities that were large enough to have both a public school and a US post office. These are towns like Kayana, which has 420 people, and it sits above the Arctic Circle. And it's not connected to any other community by road. Most of these communities are predominantly Alaska Native and in regions with the highest rates of poverty, sexual assault, and suicide in the United States. Kayana is actually one of the lucky communities because in 2019, at least, they had a local cop. This is Annie Reed. She's now a 52-year-old grandmother, and she was Kayana's village police officer in 2019 when we visited. She gets the call whenever there's a robbery, domestic dispute, or rape, or suicide. She doesn't carry a gun. She has no body armor. And after 5 years on the job, she's only received 3 weeks of training. For other communities who don't have somebody like Annie Reed, that means they had no state troopers, no certified city police officers, no village public safety officers, no village police officers or tribal police officers. These are towns like you might find all over Southeast Ohio. But the main difference is that the only way in or out is by small plane. So in an emergency, like if somebody was threatening suicide or starts shooting their gun in town, then it falls on the state troopers to respond. If the weather is bad and the planes are grounded, that can take hours or days or even longer. If Athens didn't have any local law enforcement, it wouldn't be that hard to get police to respond from a nearby community or even another state. They would just get in a car and drive. But Alaska's geography and weather make that impossible. In our reporting, we verified cases where it took troopers over a week to respond to cases of violent crime like shootings. This leaves the communities isolated and sometimes forces residents to respond on their own. The community of Russian Mission, where this girl is visiting the grave of her baby sister, recently had to wait until a man who was shooting up the town, they waited until he fell asleep. And then they ran into his house and duct taped him until the troopers could fly in and arrest him. As bad as that sounds, what if you lived in a village where the city cop is a registered sex offender? Or is somebody with a criminal record of vehicle theft, domestic violence, drunk driving, assault? We found 42 tribal and city police officers that have rap sheets that would make them ineligible for a job as a cop or even a private security guard in most of the country. Even Annie Reed, the woman you saw earlier, she has a history of run-ins with the law. She pleaded guilty to a harassment charge in 2016 and misdemeanor assault in 2012. In Stebbins, a community of about 650 people on the coast of Norton Sound, all seven of the cops working on July 1st, 2019 had pleaded guilty to domestic violence charges within the past decade. And only one had received formal law enforcement training of any kind. But in communities like Stebbins, they are sometimes the only applicants for the job. This photo by my colleague, Bill Roth, it shows former Stebbins Village police officer, Nimarron Mike, who was hired even though he's a registered sex offender and has spent a total of 6 years in jail. Part of the problem is that nobody's keeping track of who these cops are. The state agency that is supposed to regulate Alaska police doesn't keep track. And the communities that hire the cops, they're supposed to report the names of who they hire, but they often don't. This was the first time that anyone had compiled a comprehensive list of law enforcement in the state. And hiring cops with a rap sheet, it has consequences beyond the immediate public safety response. If a case relies on an arrest or an investigation by someone with a criminal history themselves, then a prosecutor might decide not to put that person in front of a jury, and instead they might just drop the charges. And like I said earlier, it leaves the residents of these villages to fend for themselves. This man, he works at the city-run liquor store in Kiana, and he carries a gun to protect the store from people trying to steal from him. But at the same time, you know, in all of these communities, life goes on. This is a church service in Kiana. Or this family boat ride down the river in Mountain Village, population 620. They've also struggled to retain a law enforcement presence. Some of these communities were not occupied year-round until after Western contact. Sometimes a religious group would build a trading post or an orphanage or a church. More often, the Bureau of Indian Affairs would build a school, essentially forcing the community to be placed in a certain place. I met this man, Stephen Duffy, in the summer of 2019 in Russian Mission. He showed me his tattoos, a heart for his mom and the initials of his girlfriend. And then he told me about how much money he could make selling pills in the village. Last year in 2021, state troopers received a report that Duffy and two other men were terrorizing other members of the community, assaulting them and trying to rob them. Troopers arrived the next day to arrest Duffy, but they couldn't find him. It took 5 days before they finally caught him. Earlier in the summer, in the same village, Russian Mission, a group of men ambushed some boaters, shooting and injuring one person. That was July 28th. Troopers made their first arrest in that case on October 25th and didn't arrest the final two suspects until November 15th, the same day they arrested Stephen Duffy, the tattooed man. It took nearly 4 months for them to make arrests in that case. And if you look at a map, it's easy to see how somebody can just disappear. You know, each of these communities, except for the regional hub, Bethel, they have under 500 people. And this is an area the size of West Virginia. This was Russian Mission's last permanent certified cop. It's a photo my colleague Mark Lester took in 2004. Simeon Askowek was the village public safety officer from 1992 to 2005. In 2005, he spoke at a hearing about the challenges of working in his community. While the state paid his salary, the city government couldn't afford utilities for the police station. So he bought heating oil out of his own pocket. After describing his predicament, he flew back home to Russian Mission. And 2 days later, he committed suicide. His son, Nikifor, still lives in Russian Mission with his family. Nikifor tried for a while to follow in his father's footsteps. He worked for 18 months as a city police officer until he had to respond to a friend's suicide, and he quit that day. The median household income in the village is $35,000. and the household might be include the immediate family and extended family. Groceries, gas, and utilities cost around double what they would in a hub community like Anchorage or Fairbanks, which in turn costs a lot more than it would things would cost here. Life in Russian Mission revolves around subsistence. Trapping in the winter, fishing in the summer, hunting in the fall. Yupik settlers who originally arrived in the area would camp along the Yukon River following the salmon. One of these camps became the village now known as Russian Mission. Russian Orthodox missionaries established a permanent settlement there in about 1837. The first Russian Orthodox church was built around 1851, and today it sits in disrepair atop a hill overlooking the village. The church is still an important part of the community, and most people identify as Russian Orthodox. And the priest hosts Sunday brunch every week at his house. As part of our reporting on this project, we produced two 360-degree videos. The idea behind this was to bring our readers into a place in a more immersive and interactive way. And we also wanted to highlight some of the aspects of life in these communities that didn't make it into our stories. This is our piece from Russian Mission. Normally you would experience this yourself and you'd get to, you know, look around, change your viewpoint, but I guess I'll do it myself.
Sorry about that.
No, she saw, I don't know where she went yet to go up. Is this? Oh, if she come and tell her your car.
Wait, the rock, I'll show you the phone. Yeah, right there, the rock. Keep that one on your finger.
Okay.
Let them open it.
Thank you.
rock, paper, scissors.
I don't know if anyone's ever worked with 360 video, but it's a very different way of thinking. You sort of have to place it somewhere and then walk away so you're not in the picture. The next project is the portrait project, Unheard. It was a follow-up to our Lawless project. We wanted to do something really different and personal. We dedicated an entire month in the print paper for this project. I'll share with you some of the photos that I took for the project, but I should emphasize that most of the credit for this goes to my colleagues at ProPublica, Adriana Gallardo, Agnes Chang, and Nadia Sussman, as well as my colleagues at the Anchorage Daily News, Kyle Hopkins and Michelle Terrio Boots. They came up with a concept, they managed the outreach, and they did a lot of the hard work interviewing each subject before I even got involved. I'll read a little bit from our introduction. Alaska has the highest rate of sexual assault in the nation, nearly 4 times the national average. About 1/3 of women in Alaska have experienced sexual violence in their lifetimes. These 29 women and men did not choose to be violated, but now they are choosing to speak about what happened to them. I'll go through each photo chronologically as they were published in the print edition, but that was really just one way that we shared the project. The whole project, all 29 photos, was published simultaneously in the Anchorage Daily News website and on ProPublica. And then I'll get to a third way the photos were presented at the end. This is Kayla. She was 29 when this was published. She's a heavy equipment operator and a student at the University of Alaska Fairbanks. She was so young when she was molested that she didn't even recognize it as molestation. It took her until she was in her 20s to file a police report. Past projects about sexual assault often focus on the haunting trauma. But instead, we wanted to portray the strength of our subjects and focus on who they've become. None of the participants in our project chose to be assaulted, but they did choose to share their experience with us. We wanted to reframe the perception of sexual assault survivors. This is Meta. She was 15 when she lost her virginity to rape. She told a few of her friends what had happened, but she never reported it to law enforcement. She's one of 300 people who responded to our call out. We asked Alaskans for their personal stories of rape and sexual assault. Through interviews with those 300 people, certain themes began to appear. Some people were assaulted more than once. Some didn't report what happened because they didn't think anyone would believe them. Others did report, but they watched as the justice was not delivered. And still others felt victimized by the system that was supposed to help them. This is David. He grew up in Alaska, but he lives in Portland, Oregon now. When he was 7 years old, he was abused by an older boy. He didn't tell anyone about his abuse until he was an adult. And now he makes a point of sharing his story with others. The photographic process that we used in this project was pretty different from anything I've been used to before. They're all collaborations, more so than any other project I've worked on. When we were interviewing the nearly 300 people who responded to our call out, we identified a group of people who suggested that they would be willing to speak publicly about their experience. We wrote them an email explaining what we were doing and why. This is what the email said. Many of you want to talk. You say speaking about your experience is a form of justice. You want other people to feel less alone. You want to support one another. We know you didn't choose to have the experience of sexual assault. Now, if you choose to speak, we want you to feel empowered by the process. Part of what that meant was that the subject got to choose how they wanted to be represented. For example, Marie here, she chose to be photographed dancing to a Yupik healing song. She wanted to be surrounded by people. I made a lot of other photos with her in different situations, but this is the one that she chose to be represented by. Normally, as a photographer, I or my photo editor, we would choose what photos get published. But this project was all about empowering the survivors. So in the end, the subject got to both see the photos before they were published, and they got to choose what particular photo got published if they wanted to do that. So not only did they get to choose what photo gets published, but they got to decide whether to participate at all. They had the ability to back out completely right up until we published this piece. And some of them did. You know, I traveled to Fairbanks, 350 miles from my home in Anchorage, and I made what I thought were some great photos of a survivor and her family. The interview was already done, the story was already written, but a few weeks later, she decided not to participate. You know, I was bummed as a photographer, but this project is not about me. These two portraits were also taken in Fairbanks. And it's really powerful for me to see because it's a mother and her daughter, both of whom are survivors. The mother, Barbara, was a teenager in the 1970s when she was drugged and she woke up the next morning without her clothes. She never reported the assault. When her daughter, Jessica, was 17, she was raped at a house party. At first, Jessica didn't want to report the rape because she'd been drinking herself. When her mom found out, she insisted on driving Jessica to the police station. In the end, Jessica decided not to go to court because she didn't want to endure what she knew would be a re-traumatizing situation. Penelope is one of the many survivors of child sexual abuse that we spoke with. She was assaulted again in her mid-20s, and after that, she didn't hesitate to report it that time. She went right away to the emergency room. She had a forensic exam. She gave an interview with the police. She was really hopeful that her case would be investigated. That was 3 years ago when we published this, 5 years ago now. And no arrests have been made. The Anchorage Police Department says it has suspended its investigation. Sue was the oldest survivor that I photographed. When she was 25 in 1972, she moved from California to the oil boom town of Fairbanks. The Trans-Alaska pipeline was being built. A year later, she was sexually assaulted by a man who held a knife against her neck. She immediately reported it, but it took 2 years before the man was arrested. Throughout the whole process, she said she felt discouraged by the police, the prosecutors, and the people around her. When I met Sue, we sat and talked for hours in her kitchen before I even took out a camera. Even though she had already told her story to a reporter, she wanted to tell me in person. She wanted me to meet her cats. She wanted me to have a cup of coffee, and she wanted to hear my story about how I used to visit Fairbanks as a kid when my dad was in grad school, a decade and a half after her assault. Something I learned about learned throughout this whole process was that it couldn't be rushed. Many of these women and men had waited years before telling anyone about what had happened to them. And being a part of the project, speaking publicly about what happened, was a really big deal for them. And having their photo published alongside the story, it's unbelievably brave. As we were reporting this project, one of the themes we found was a connection between child sexual abuse and survivors coping with their abuse by using drugs and alcohol. When I met Ricky, she had been in segregation at Highland Mountain Correctional Center, a women's prison outside of Anchorage. She was let out for a short time to meet with the reporter and I and two other incarcerated women. And after the interview, she returned to segregation. She was born premature and diagnosed with fetal alcohol spectrum disorder. As a child, when she was being abused, she would black out. By 13, she was drinking and using drugs. Her most recent arrest was in 2018 when she tried to ram a stolen truck through a police barricade. She acknowledges that what she did was wrong, but she points out that while she's in prison, the man who abused her lives free. Some of the survivors we included in this piece chose not to be identified by their name or photo. They placed an incredible amount of trust in us to follow through with their wishes, especially when it came to photos. It was challenging to make a portrait of someone and not have them be identifiable. But these women and I worked together to make a portrait that we were both happy with. Normally, as journalists, we are the gatekeepers. We decide what to write. We decide which quotes to publish, what photos to run. But this was different. For this project, we were not the gatekeepers. We were collaborators. Even though this project ran afoul of all those traditional journalism customs, we still made sure that each story adheres to the journalistic standards of accuracy, fairness, and rigor that we demand of every story published by the Anchorage Daily News or ProPublica. That means that every detail in these profiles has been fact-checked. Whenever possible, we reviewed all relevant documents, including police and court documents, medical records. We attempted to verify memories and past events with contemporaneous accounts, including interviews with other community members, diaries, correspondence, and social media. We explained our fact-checking process to each participant as we discussed the quotes chosen. We occasionally omitted details based on their comfort level, but we did not change facts in any story. In most situations, we decided not to name or otherwise identify a perpetrator. Even so, we actively sought out the person who was accused and we gave them an opportunity to comment. And we've included their responses whenever possible. On the final day of the project, we ran this on our front page. No photos, no stories, just these words. Over the past month, we have presented the stories of women and men choosing to speak about their experiences with sexual violence in Alaska. Talking about rape and sexual assault is difficult. Many survivors may not be in a position to do so right now. This space is dedicated to those not yet ready to share. We're leaving this open for you. On the day that we ran that on the front page, our collaborators' photos and quotes appeared on the side of the Anchorage Museum, and they remained there for a month. This opened up the project to many people who otherwise would never have seen it. Nobody had to seek out a project. It wasn't hidden behind a paywall or inside a gallery. It was on the sidewalk, visible to anyone who walked by. And I hope it reached somebody who needed it. Thanks. Happy to answer questions or have a discussion with anybody.
questions?
Thank you for your presentation. I'd like to find out, my name is Ijeoma and I'm a graduate student here at OU. I'd like to find out how were you able to convince some of the survivors to accept to share their stories? Because sometimes it's difficult to get them to really want to talk about such traumatic experience. Thank you.
We started with a call out, so people had to come to us with their story. So we didn't, you know, we didn't, we had a conversation with them. They wanted to reach out to us, and then we talked about our project and what we wanted to be doing. And so it was really up to them. It was really driven by them and their comfort level. We didn't pressure anyone to participate. You know, and we waited until we had enough people to willing to participate to do this project over a month. So we were patient, and it was really driven by the survivors themselves.
Thank you. What was the, did you have any unforeseen difficulties going from a traditional journalistic process to a more collaborative one?
Normally, when I take photos, you know, I don't share them with the subject. It's part of how we remain independent. But this was very different. It wasn't an independent project. We were facilitating this, the survivors being able to share their stories. So we had to set it up in a way that it was, you know, still accurate and fair, but some of those walls just had to come down.
How is it working with the 360? 360 VR is like a new medium. It's just coming up now. So how was it using it in a journalistic piece?
We started out with trying to figure out just how to use it. Like, not just technically, but like, how do we use it to tell a story? And what we landed on was, you know, it's a way to take people to a place that they would never otherwise get to go. You know, you get to go inside homes, you get to ride on a sled, dog sled. So we tried to think of certain ways, certain situations where we could use it. And then in the end, it was supplementary to the project. There was a learning curve for sure, technologically too. So it's still something we're learning, we're figuring out. I had to 3D print some parts to it to attach it to the drone, and you know, we actually lost it on the dog sled. We had to find it in the snow later, so there were a lot of challenges with that, but I think it was worth it.
Hello, I'm Christy, and I'm with the Athens Photographic Project. I'm just gobsmacked. I've always wanted to go to Alaska, but you brought it to me, and I just wanted to thank you for that. And then the other thing is, as a survivor myself, thank you. You know, it's that kind of trauma and that kind of post-traumatic stress, nobody would ever touch it because it's like, oh, yuck. But you brought it to life, and you brought that part of, I don't want to say humanity, but you brought that humanity out in those photographs. And we have my brain is like, yeah. We have a photo project on the parking garage that you might want to check out, because each and every photograph and photographer, they struggle with a mental illness. And I started the project when you graduated in 2007. So it's kind of like, oh, cool. So, you know, it's just, thank you so much for sharing that. And as I said, as a Sir Thriver myself, you brought the humanity out in that, and I appreciate it very much. Thank you.
Thank you. We do need to talk about it more. It shouldn't be something that is not spoken about.
Yeah. I wanted to ask a question about the process of how long it took from having the idea for Unheard until you got everything in place where you could start making imagery. So like how long in terms of time did that take? Because I'm sure something that complex has a lot of moving parts.
We started the Lawless project in the spring of 2019. And I think through some of those first interviews and visiting some of those communities, we started thinking about where this would take us. So it began more than a year before we published those photos. And there were some, you know, roadblocks along the way and some delays. So, you know, we wanted to make sure if we're going to do it, it's going to be respectful and empowering to the people who chose to share with us. So we weren't rushing it. You know, we wanted to do it earlier, but it was never ready until it was ready.
As you spoke, I think about Athens, and we have very similar stories going on here in some news desert areas. And that's frustrating because we know we can do a lot more. But can you speak about the results of this story, and has anything changed? Has law enforcement changed? Have politicians paid attention? And I'm afraid you're of the answer a little bit.
There was a lot that happened after that. Those pieces were published. The Attorney General came to Alaska, Bill Barr. He toured some of these communities. He promised a lot of money, and the money came. The governor said he would hire people. But nothing's really changed. A lot of talk. Some things have been tried, but we're still struggling with the same things. We haven't done an accounting again to see where those communities are without law enforcement, but I wouldn't be surprised if it's pretty similar. I went to a few communities this summer that had no law enforcement. So, sorry to say.
As a photographer, can you talk a little bit about that sharing of power that you did with those subjects and what that felt like for you and what you learned from it?
A lot of time when I take a photo of something, some situation or a person, and it's published, they'll reach out and say, "Hey, I like that photo. Can I get a copy?" And it's always a little awkward because we have certain rules that we follow and as to, you know, maintain our independence, especially unpublished work. We don't share that with anyone normally, but it was just very different. I mean, they were trusting us to share their story in a way that was empowering to them. You know, they didn't have to. You know, they knew we gave them all the power. They could leave whenever they wanted. They could choose the photo. you know, they came up with the ideas of where to go, what situations to be photographed in, how they wanted to be portrayed. So I just had to be a facilitator, you know, less so than a photographer. So that's kind of how I saw myself. It was humbling. I mean, I don't have a personal experience with sexual assault like these people do, but I can empathize and I can honor their experience as best I can. That's kind of what I was focusing on.
Hi, I'm Dene Navajo, and a lot of the images of the Native tribal people there, I can associate with, being also a person that came from poverty. I just wanted to ask you if you asked them why they stayed.
In those traditional communities.
I know the answer, but I want these people to also know the answer if you asked.
You know, I never asked that question specifically. I know that their identity is tied to the land, is their customs and subsistence lifestyle is dependent on being where they are. I mean, that's why they traditionally were in those areas. Oh, you know, a lot of people move to Anchorage from rural Alaska, and they can get lost in Anchorage. It's very different, very different lifestyle. I'd be curious to hear what your thoughts are, though, about that too.
Just speaking as a Navajo, and from my reservation, my land, it's the same reason. It's because we're part of the land. The land is part of us. And we put ourselves in those situations, not only because of our own well-being, but also because the government wants us to fail. They want us to give those lands to the government so that we are no longer identified as Native people. In a sense, the genocide that they created in colonization is still happening right now, because they are doing it in subtle ways of being able to take a lot of the rights by treaty. They do not honor. There's a lot of things that the government doesn't do for Native people that they were promised. And a lot of people will come to reservations and look at Native people as being lazy, or not being able to work, or don't want to work. But it's actually the government who's strangling those benefits away from the tribal people. And the reason that my land in Arizona is still lived with my family is because of that reason, is because we identify ourselves with the land. And if we lose the land, we lose our identity.
Yeah, I just worked on a project this year. It's the 50th anniversary of the Alaska Native Claims Settlement Act. In Alaska, we don't have reservations. There's one reservation in Alaska. So the land claims issue is very different. When oil was discovered, you know, they needed to build a pipeline to bring it to a port. And so they needed to settle some land claims issues, and it was a very rushed process, and we're still dealing with the legacy of that today. It was not fair.
I had a question just with Wallace. How, with it being such a vast area, how did you determine which villages to go or which towns to go to, and which, you know, when it's tough to access just for you, how to then have the time with these individuals and all these different places to just get that access and kind of make them comfortable for you to be there and make photographs with them?
a lot of it came from the research that my the reporter Kyle Hopkins had done. He reached out to all these communities, and sometimes it would take a dozen phone calls before somebody would answer, just so we could find out, hey, do you have a cop in town? Like, and so through those conversations, he got a sense of who would be open to having us visit, where there were certain issues that a community was facing that we wanted to highlight. We started with that, and then logistics followed after that. And, there's no hotels in these places. You stay in the high school or the school, usually.
Yeah, hi. Oh, this is really loud. Thank you for this amazing presentation. I really enjoyed your pictures, in particular these vast landscapes that are just fascinating. But I also had a question about the Lawless Project. It looks like you basically followed principles of trauma-informed reporting. Did you get some training on that beforehand, or did you just basically make it up as you went? Or can you talk a little bit more about, like, how did you prepare all that?
I haven't personally received any training in that. I know that some of our reporters have, and also we reached out to the community and some leaders in that in the Native communities, and then trauma, who do trauma work. So they helped guide us through that process. That was especially important in the Unheard Project, the portrait series. It's a trauma is a issue that we deal with in Alaska a lot. Historical trauma from, even during the pandemic, when I was covering the Iditarod in 2020, it was March, the pandemic was just getting started, and the Iditarod goes through some communities that are still dealing with trauma from the 1918 Spanish flu. Their whole communities were, everyone over the age of 18 died, and they're still dealing with that trauma. So it's part of what we think about in almost anything we do. And we do have some training in that, but not, we could always use more.
Please join me in thanking Loren Holmes again. We are going to take a lunch break. If we can have the thank you slide. There we go. That thanks our donors tells you a little bit more about them. We hope you'll enjoy lunch. We'll be back here at 1:30 with Kendall Harkness and Richard Song Tatari from the Minneapolis Star Tribune, sharing work from their 2021 Pulitzer Prize winning work about the death of George Floyd. Thank you so much. Wow.